Hello everyone, Stepan here. I'll go over another one of Bobby Fischer's amazing victories. This one he played in Zürich 59, and this tournament was one of the biggest chess tournaments ever held up until that point. It was played in Zürich, Switzerland in May of 59, and a lot of amazingly strong grandmasters were invited to fight the six best Swiss grandmasters, first of which was of course Dieter Keller, who was at that time even a contender for the candidates tournament, and he was at the world's top in chess. He was never one of the top five or top three, but he was a strong contender for all of the titles. And of course, they invited Mikhail Tal, who was at the time the strongest chess player alive, along with Mikhail Botevnik, who was still the world champion, but Tal would take the title from him just next year. And another Russian who was invited was Paul Keres, Paul II. He was Estonian, actually, but he played for the Soviet Union. From Yugoslavia, they invited Svetozar Gligorić, and from the States, they invited Bobby Fischer, of course. There were other strong names playing, like Bent Larsen, but those were the most famous ones. Bobby Fischer finished third, actually. Tal won, same as in the Portorož Interzonal just last year, the year before that. And he would also, of course, go on to win the candidates tournament in Bled-Zagreb-Belgrade, so there was no really stopping him, and there were no real contenders to him during that time, during 59 and 60. Svetozar Gligorić of Yugoslavia was second, and Bobby was third. And in this game he played Wolfgang Unzicker, who was the strongest German grandmaster at the time. He was actually born in 1925, so he wasn't Fischer's generation, he was one of the old-timers. But he was one of the strongest Europeans, GMs, if you don't count Yugoslavia or Russia or the Soviet Union. He was born in a small town of Pirmasens. I'm not sure how to pronounce that name, and excuse me if you're a German viewer. And he actually died just recently, only 10 years ago, at 80-something. So he was a very strong player all his life, and his peak rating was sometime in 1971. So at this point in 59, he wasn't still at his full strength. And of course, Bobby Fischer was just 16 at this point, so he wasn't either, but he had just become the US champion, so he was starting to get good. In this game, Bobby had the white pieces. He opened with pawn to e4, and Unzicker goes for the Roy Lopez Bobby goes for the Roy Lopez, Unzicker plays e5, and we have knight to f3, knight to c6, bishop to b5, the Roy Lopez. Unzicker doesn't go for the Berlin, which wasn't yet popular at the time. He plays a6. Bobby doesn't play the exchange Roy Lopez, of course. He goes for the most fighting lines with bishop to a4. And now knight to f6, castles, bishop to e7, entering the closed Roy Lopez, rook to e1, b5, chasing the bishop away, bishop to b3, d6. Of course, in this position, black could have also castled, and then after c3 he could have gone for the martial attack, but d6 is continuing the closed Roy Lopez and entering some of the most complicated theoretical variations. So d6, c3, now black castles, white has to play h3 in this position to prevent the bishop from pinning the knight on g4, which would indirectly undefend the d4 square, which is white's main idea in the closed Roy Lopez. And now from this position, Unzicker goes for the Chigorin defense with knight to a5. And if you are unfamiliar with all the moves so far up until move 9 with h3 and knight to a5, I would recommend you watch the video I made on the basics of the Roy Lopez and the closed Roy Lopez. I will put the link in the description below. And with knight to a5 entering the Chigorin, if you are unfamiliar with the theory of the Chigorin, I have made a detailed video just on that opening, so I will link it below as well. And by the way, excuse the background noises which you might hear. There is a lot of construction work going on at the moment in my neighborhood, so there might be some noises after I start the game. So now bishop to c2 is the main move, of course. The move knight to a5 is designed to gain a tempo on the bishop, which has to retreat, which is why white played c3 in the first place, along to be able to push d4. And the main idea for black is to chase the bishop away and after that play c5 and return the knight back to c6 after the c-pawn has moved and black has gained a bigger center. So bishop to c2, c5, the most common moves. This variation is still played today. It's highly theoretical, and it's actually one of the most aggressive and best ways for black to fight against the Spanish game. Now d4, white has prepared his pawn push with c3, so why not play it? Queen to c7, once again the most common move. Knight b to d2. Bishop to d7. Now, this is not the most common idea in this position. After knight b to d2, the most common move for black is either c takes d4, or bishop to d7 is the second one, but c takes d4 has more than 3,000 games played, grandmaster games. So is the most common idea, but bishop to d7 is technically better than that. So now bishop to d7, and white goes for his common plan in the Roy Lopez, the knight maneuver, and since the c3 square will usually be taken by the pawn in order to be able to save the bishop and to play d4, the knight has a plan of transferring to d2, f1, and then usually to g3, and the point of the knight being on g3 is to control f5, and if this bishop ever disappears, if it ever gets exchanged for white's bishop, then the knight on f5 will usually be the strongest piece on the board, as Ben Feingold would say, knife to f5. So now he continues with his plan, knight to f1, trying to transfer it to g3, rook f to e8, developing the rook, and black usually in the Chigorin has a plan of playing g6, bishop to f8, and then usually, bishop to h6, in order to be able to develop the bishop, because it's pretty blocked behind the d-pawn. After rook f to e8, knight to e3 is played. He isn't going for knight to g3. Knight to e3 is more active in this position, and it's controlling the center. It's actually a better move than knight to g3. G6, trying to develop the bishop. D takes e5, resolving some of the central tension. D takes e5, and now knight to h2 by Bobby. He has found a new plan in the position, and the plan is actually, since g6 is a weakening move, and usually white will have ideas of playing g4 and then transferring the knight from f1 to g3, but since he played knight to e3, a common idea is to challenge the knight on f6 and the bishop on d7 by doubling his knights on the g4 square. So now after rook a to d8, queen to f3, of course he has to get away from the stare of the rook along the d-file, and now bishop to e6, opening up the rook, and now knight h to g4. And this is actually exploiting the fact that black wasted the tempo to put the bishop on e6, because the bishop will probably get exchanged. Now knight takes g4, h takes g4, he takes with the pawn, which is not the most precise capture he could have played. Of course, taking with the queen isn't possible, but taking with the knight wouldn't activate this pawn, which is now pretty strong in this position. Queen to c6, challenging e4, g5, knight to c4, knight to g4, and now black will have to give up his bishop, because if the knight ever gets to f6 or to h6, then white is strategically winning. So that's why I said placing the bishop on e6 from d7 was a waste of tempo, because Unzicker must have known that the knight will be coming to g4. That was the whole point behind putting the knight on h2 and to e3. So now he takes, bishop takes g4, queen takes g4, and f6. This is the... Up until this move, you can see, by the way, the evaluation in the bar on the right side of the board. Up until this move, white has a slight opening edge and nothing major. The position is pretty much equal. But f6 is such a weakening move, and it opens up black's king completely, that after this, you could argue that black has a much worse or even a losing position. So f6, and of course, Bobby captures that with g takes f, and now you can see that all the files are open towards black king, and the king won't have a happy future. Instead of f6, what he should have played was simply rook to d7, trying to double rooks, or try to activate his knight back into the game, because it's pretty inactive on c4, and play knight to b6, transfer it back to the center, perhaps try to challenge the pawn on g5 by playing h6 later on, if it becomes possible, etc. But after f6 and g takes f, Bobby is just much better. Unzicker, of course, captures with the bishop. And now Bobby had two good moves from here. One was to place the bishop on b3 and pin the knight, and in best case scenario, double black's pawns, and this would be strategically completely winning, because any endgame would be much better for white. Or to play a4 and to challenge the b5 pawn, and then attack the knight with the bishop later on. But he plays a4 immediately, and now knight to b6, attacking the a4 pawn, a takes b5, and bishop to e3, activating the bishop, attacking c5. And now already you can see that white's position is much more comfortable to play. If you consider king safety, then white's king is perfectly safe. There is nothing black can do to attack it, and another major factor is that white has the a-file for the moment. His rook is active along the a-file. And the most important thing is the bishop pair, especially the light-squared bishop that has no counterpart in the position. And black's knight really isn't able to challenge this bishop, which is now on c2, but it will become one of White's most powerful pieces. Now, after bishop to e3, centralizing his bishop and connecting his rooks, Unzicker plays rook to a8, challenging the rook, but he can't really take. If he takes, then e rook takes on a1, and White still has the a file. Bobby just plays rook e to d1, wasting a tempo, knowing that Unzicker can't take the rook for now. King to h8, a prophylactic move, but perhaps there was something more active to do. b3. Solidifying his position, bishop to g7, queen to h4, and now this queen to h4 move is very important, because now in some positions White is actually threatening to capture the rook on a8, and then he will have the d8 square, because it's now challenged by the queen and by the rook. So this is a very strong positional move, which not many players would consider, I think. Bishop to f6, Wolfgang has to challenge the queen, and now bishop to g5, not moving the queen, but offering a trade of bishops. Bishop takes, queen takes, and now Unzicker does trade. Rook takes a1, rook takes a1, and now knight to d7. And this is the idea that he should have played earlier, instead of f6, just transferring the knight back into the game. Because now Black is able to challenge the queen from f6, it's supporting the rook on f8, and the knight is much better on d7 than it was on c4, if you remember 10 or so moves ago. Now bishop to d1 by Bobby. This is another amazing move by him, because the bishop is completely blocked along this diagonal, and there's nothing it's doing here, so this diagonal is much more active. And let me just show you one continuation, why Black can't really take on here, because of bishop to f3. And now after, let's say, queen to f4, trying to exchange queens, then queen takes f4, e takes f4, and bishop to c6 is just winning. If the rook defends from here, then pinning the rook would win the game. So after knight to d7, bishop to d1, Unzicker doesn't take the pawn, of course, he is a strong grandmaster. Knight to f6, he attacks the e4 pawn twice now. Rook to a7, threatening a lot of things now, and queen to d6. In this position, of course, he can't capture the pawn on e4. If he does, this is an unavoidable mate in three moves, which it might not seem that way, but if knight takes e4, attacking the queen, then queen to h6 is a mate in two moves, whatever Black does. There is no way to prevent White from checkmating on h7. He would have to give up his queen on c7, and after rook takes, if he tries rook to e7, giving up one more piece, then queen to f8 is just checkmate. So after bishop to d1, knight to f6, rook to a7, he doesn't take, he plays queen to d6, which is a much more active move. It's attacking the bishop on d1 and actually threatening something. Bishop to e2, rook to e7, challenging the rook, and now of course Bobby has no problem exchanging a couple of pieces, because his position is strategically much stronger, and the bishop is of course much stronger than the knight on f6, and he's attacking b5, he's controlling all the key squares and all the key diagonals. So rook takes e7, queen takes e7, and now bishop takes b5, going a pawn up, and this is just lost for Black. And if a lesser player was playing White, okay, there might have been some chances, but Bobby can't draw this or lose this. Of course, once again, Black can't take on e4, this time the queen is hanging, so he can't regain the pawn. He plays king to g7, trying to get the king into the game, defending the knight so the queen can move. Bishop to e2, queen to c7, queen to e3, now he has to defend the e4 pawn, queen to a5, g3, making some more luft and preventing the knight from entering some key squares. Queen to a3, attacking the b3 pawn. Now king to g2, ignoring that, but Black doesn't really have time to capture on b3. That would have been a very weakening move, and Black will also lose the c5 pawn if he does that. So if he takes on b3, just queen takes c5. So he plays queen to a5. We have queen to d3, queen to b6, queen to c4, queen to c6, and now Bobby is just trying to exchange the queens comfortably and win a bishop versus knight endgame, in which of course White has much better chances, because the bishop is controlling the entire board and the knight is too slow to challenge it. So now bishop to d3, defending e4, it was attacked twice, queen to b6, b4, c takes b4, knight to g4. This is now attacking the f2 pawn, so Bobby has to be careful. And queen to c5, offering a trade. And surprisingly, Unzicker obliges and he takes. okay, there's not much else he can do because Bobby is threatening a lot of things and his B pawn will march up the board, but this is just losing now. I don't know why he didn't resign if he wanted to exchange queens. So now queen takes c5, b takes c5, and you can see immediately that this pawn is pretty much unstoppable, and that in order to stop it, black is either going to have to give up the knight or drag the king away from the kingside pawns, which will then be easily picked up by white after he creates a pass pawn here. And this is now just a losing bishop versus knight endgame. So now king to f7, f4, king to e7, king to f3, the knight is attacked, knight to f6, bishop to b5. This is now cutting out the king from entering the position. All the squares are covered. The king has to go around, so he goes to e6. Bishop to c4 check, king to e7, c6 advancing the pawn, knight to e8, he has to stop c7 now. This is now just unavoidable queening for white. F takes c5, going two pawns up, h6, queen to e3, knight to c7, king to d4, activating the king, h5. But black's pawns are really too slow, and not that they're too slow, they're impossible to queen, because white always has time to sacrifice the bishop for the last remaining pawn. So, and three pawns versus knight is just winning for white, whatever happens. King to e3, g5, bishop to e2, h4, g takes, bishop to c4, knight to e8, king to f4, getting closer to the h pawn, king to d8, king to g4, and what do you do if you're black here? There's absolutely nothing. You're going to lose your last pawn, and white won't even have to sacrifice the bishop for it. So king to c7, attacking the c6 pawn, bishop to f7, attacking the knight, not letting black just simply recapture the pawn, knight to g7, king takes h4, king takes c6, and after king to g5, Unzicker gave up and resigned. And of course, there's no way to prevent white from winning. This is, the evaluation is plus 99, believe it or not, in this position. So okay, this was a very nice victory for Bobby Fischer, and it's unlike his other victories. Usually you expect him to sacrifice a few pieces or to attack along the king side or to break through with some pawn sacrifices or something. But this was actually a great example of the Russian school of chess in one of the openings which was highly theoretical at the time, and which all the strong grandmasters played. This is the Spanish game or the Royal Lopez, and the Chigorin variation, which grew in popularity in 10 years before this game. And in the Zürich Open tournament, there were at least 20 Spanish games played, and the Chigorin was the most favored variation. So he actually beat a strong grandmaster in what wasn't his strongest side. But later on, he will become much stronger in positional play as well. And this tournament is probably the start of his rise in chess. And this tournament is what marked him as one of the contenders for the world title. He will actually be much stronger in the candidates and in the interzonal cycle in the start of the 60s than he was in 58 and 59 in Porto Rojo, and that he will be in the candidates in Bled-Zagreb-Belgrade. So he wasn't ready yet to become the world champion, but he soon will be. Okay, everybody, thanks very much for watching. I hope you liked this positional brilliancy by Bobby Fischer against Wolfgang Unzicker, and stay tuned for more chess. Thanks very much. Bye.